Welcome to Under the Hood, the Faculty Position Series. May these tips propel you along your journey. Welcome everyone to part 7 of the Faculty Position Series. In this segment, I'm going to discuss the important aspects of ramping up your lab, your research group as a first-year faculty member. Just as a reminder, I discussed the faculty mid-pre-tenure transfer experience in season 2 of episode 8 of the Under the Hood series. So this part 7 segment will largely be targeted to brand new first year faculty. So in this video, I'm going to discuss the key contacts, priority resources, research group management strategies, course instruction, productivity benchmarks, merit and evaluations, general best practices, and I'll end the segment with advice on finishing up any work that you have in progress. As a caveat, I do not discuss grant writing in this video because that information is presented in the season 1, episode 3, video for Under the Hood with Mitch Boritz. So I hope this video is helpful, and if I left anything out and if you have other questions, feel free to put those below in the comment section. So first I'll discuss the key contacts that you need to find and start to communicate with. I also discussed key contacts in episode 8, season 2 of Under the Hood, but I think I will reiterate them here for your reference. The first person you'll need to talk to is the facilities coordinator, who handles new furniture orders, planning, rendering of your space, office, and lab renovations. This person will coordinate any site visits from space designers, and they will submit your work orders to get those renovations completed. The lab safety coordinator obviously helps you get your lab certifications approved. They will help you coordinate training for you and your students and let you know where you can get personal protective equipment. The pre-award analyst is the person that will help you prepare grants, maybe write them, maybe not, but they will facilitate submitting these grants to sponsoring organizations. The post-award coordinator is the person who, once you get funded or you get an award notification, they will handle the paperwork that's required to set up the agreement between the university and the sponsoring organization. And they will probably also manage any spending that you do from those external award accounts. In some cases, the pre-award coordinator is the same as the post-award coordinator. Then you'll need to contact the graduate student advisor to secure any hiring and stipend amounts and ensure that any students that you have recruited in your first year are properly enrolled in the program. So that's a priority for students or for faculty that have students in their first semester. Next, you'll want to contact the purchasing coordinator, who helps you submit purchase orders for equipment, supplies, etc. They will handle any invoices. It's up to you to go and get quote from vendors, and then the purchasing coordinator can coordinate setting up the vendors within the system so that they can receive funds from your accounts. The next person you should contact or figure out who this person is the personnel manager. So in most departments, there's somebody that handles HR, summer salary requests, etc. And so your personnel manager will help you figure out how much summer salary you want to deduct from your startup account if you're provided that in your startup. And you'll want to do this right away, because if you're hired in July, if you're on the semester system, you can only get paid for July and August. If you're on the quarter system and you start in July, you can get paid for July, August, and September. So just ask specific questions about how to get your summer salary paid in your first year. You also want to really talk to the personnel manager about insurance and make sure that you have the correct designations and the correct designations for your retirement. Then there may be a separate person who manages the department funding, meaning they are responsible for tallying up the spending from your startup account. So this is the list of key contacts that I think are important to engage with right away upon starting your position. And be sure to keep a good relationship with these people because they help to keep your ship running. The next thing I'll discuss are priority resources that you need to secure, find out, etc. Number one, get your NET ID or the ID that's associated with your credentials across campus and get your email address set up right away. You'll probably also want to set up forwarding from your current institution and send all of those emails to your new faculty email so that will help you with email management. So right now I have all my email coming to my Berkeley account. If there is a new faculty handbook, go ahead and get your hands on it because it can fill in the blanks about internet connections, printing, etc. In that handbook and maybe on the websites, you may find out that there is a department or college intranet. And so the intranet will contain electronic resources that are only available once you've authenticated with your password. And this could be helpful. You should also learn how to access what's called an academic personnel manual. So this will be a campus level document that explains the rules and regulations for being a professor. And this manual should have the specifications for merit and promotion. So you'll want to be familiar with what's expected of you, what your rights are, and this will help you advocate for yourself in the future if needed. The next three things are your mailbox, the break room, and the copier room. Go ahead and find out where these things are early on, as well as the supply closet, because sometimes you won't have that dry erase marker right before class. Your markers have dried out. You need a notepad. You know, these are things that you really don't think about when you're starting up at an institution. The next thing are kind of campus resources. You'll need to figure out parking and whether or not you'll need a parking pass. If it's free, where to park. That's really important for your day one visit. If you are working at a really big institution, you'll want to figure out the campus shuttle. So this could be helpful if you are commuting with public transportation and the train stop, the bus stop is a bit on the corner of campus. There may be a shuttle available to take you to your office building. Last but not least, for those of you that are not meal preppers, go ahead and figure out what the closest cafe is to your office where you can get that coffee, get that sandwich really quickly, and go on about your day. Because sometimes it's a struggle to balance like eating meals and keeping up with all your responsibilities. The next thing I'll talk about is how to manage your growing research group. So this is probably something that you have the least amount of experience with if you are someone who did not spend a lot of time as a research scientist running your own group at a national lab, etc. So usually in your group, you should have a combination of graduate students, postdoctoral researchers, maybe a lab manager, and undergraduate researchers. So how you manage your group will be up to you and it'll be based on your needs. And I advise you to talk to someone like a mentor or a trusted advisor about what's best for you. But I'll go over some of the nuances related to group composition. So I mentioned here sponsored grant policies on postdocs. Well, you may be tempted to just use your startup money to hire 2 to 3 postdocs to just get your lab up and running and be very productive. But there's a caveat to that. NSF has stricter policies for budgeting for postdocs. So they actually promote the mentoring and training of graduate students. So that kind of dissuades us from trying to recruit a lot of postdocs because you may not get that same support on your sponsored grants. Not only that, mentoring graduate students is harder than mentoring a postdoc, and so being able to successfully train a graduate trainee demonstrates your teaching and mentoring abilities. So these are just things to think about when it comes to structuring your group. When it comes to a lab manager, same thing. They can get things done really quickly, but it probably doesn't say much to your teaching and mentoring. I find that undergraduate researchers are really helpful for the lab. They can help with tasks that are low risk but high reward, meaning if they mess up, you know, it won't destroy your lab, but if they are successful, it could mean branching out into a new research area. It could mean possibly recruiting a student that you've helped develop, and then they eventually apply to the PhD program, and now you have 2 to 3 years of experience working with this person, and then their ramp up as a graduate student is easy. So I find that this undergraduate to graduate pipeline is super, super effective. And you can also incentivize the undergraduate research experience by providing a stipend. Benefit rates. I want to mention here that benefits or health insurance, retirement, and all that for these different levels of research staff, they differ. And so the graduate student and undergraduate student benefit rate is really, really low. And the postdoc benefit rate is mid-tier. But your professionals, like your lab managers, will have a very high benefit rate. So that's also something you need to consider when establishing the composition of your group. I'll briefly discuss recruiting. And so some of my best practices for recruiting students are the following. I'm looking for students who have genuine interest in learning and working, and it's evident that they have a high work ethic. And I'm also looking for students who are coachable, who are willing to listen and take my advice without being combative, and I'm looking for people with good attitudes. Also, I'm looking for students who have a passion for the work that I'm doing, specifically, and they can speak to why they want to work in the field of air quality. And so once again, I talked about overgeneralizing interests in a written application for faculty, and the same applies to students. It becomes really obvious to me when a student's request for advisement is overgeneralized and they have no idea what my group does. The next thing I'll talk about is actual project and group management. So electronic tools are going to be your friend here. So I've seen where professors use Calendly to schedule one-on-one meetings with students. I don't do this. I do this the old school way. I do it via email, and then I have a spreadsheet that is openly available to my group on Google Drive to manage my meetings. Also, once again, alluding to Google Drive just now, I do have a shared group drive for all my students. They can access the important paperworks, shared data, and they can share presentations and papers on this shared drive. I want to mention Notion, which is a paid product. I am not endorsing any of these products, but I found that Notion is really helpful for managing my meetings with my students, collecting updates, and being on the same page with them. I used to take handwritten notes, and that gets cumbersome because you can't hear them, or they can't hear you, and they're talking too fast, you're talking too fast. But having the students fill out a Notion card before your meeting and then going over the updates based on what's on that card and setting deliverables and goals for the next review period is helpful in Notion. Also, I pay for additional Dropbox space, and this is helpful for storing big data sets, multiple versions of papers, and it helps me to manage the share settings. So if I'm working with a student on a paper, it'll just be me and that student with access to that Dropbox, whereas the Google Drive is open to everyone. Meetings. I think this is probably the most critical of my group management strategy. I make sure that I meet individually with my team once a week. We take a hiatus after every semester because students have final exams, projects, and they need a break. But I usually schedule the meetings for 30 minutes to an hour per week for each person, and this depends on the size of the group. When I had a smaller group, I can meet with them for an hour. Now that my group is a little bit larger, everyone gets 30 minutes. As a graduate student at Georgia Tech, we had 15 minutes because our group was just that big. I find that meeting once a week really helps to keep students on track and clarify anything that they may be struggling with. This is not meant to micromanage them, but it's meant to support them in whatever they're doing. And it lets the student know that you're engaged and you care about the work that they're doing. Group meeting I hold once a week, and this is for about an hour, and the schedule changes every semester. And I find that group meetings are important for building character for your students, morale building. You know, it provides a sense of togetherness and oneness in the group. Students actually build soft research skills, like presentation skills. They learn how to conduct critical but polite discourse. You know, they learn how to challenge things without being rude. We have a journal club that we do. We review papers or the late-breaking literatures that are important to some of the projects that we have going on. Students are able to practice their presentation skills, and they can practice for any exams that they have coming up or conference presentation. They also learn to receive external feedback from their peers on their work without feeling personally attacked. So I find that group meetings are extremely nice for establishing your group. So that concludes my best practices for your research group management. The next thing I'm going to talk about are courses and the best practices for your courses. So, like I said in part 6, likely you will be given a course release in your first semester or quarter, and you should probably use that time on developing lab infrastructure and making purchases. So, when it comes to course materials, if you are unfamiliar with the subject of the course that you've been assigned, then you can ask the previous instructor for their course materials. The previous instructor has the right to say no, and if that's the case, you'll need to create your own materials. Then, in this scenario, you'll need to spend a decent amount of time developing the materials for your first offering. And as a caveat, this is the most difficult part. You know, ramping up a course for the first time is hard, and it will take a lot of time. But by the second time you teach, you're essentially improving on the first offering, and you're incorporating any suggestions from your teaching evaluations. When it comes to teaching training, there may be resources available on campus where you can go and get certified for certain teaching strategies, and you may be able to also attend workshops for improving your teaching. So for those of you that aren't confident or comfortable with classroom teaching, you may want to take advantage of some of these resources during your course release semester or quarter. When it comes to teaching assistants, they are allotted to classes based on the size of the class, most likely. So if you have a small class, you may be offered a reader or a grader. And if you are teaching a larger class, you may have up to 3 TAs. When it comes to engineering programs, some of the courses are considered ABET courses or courses that are evaluated for ABET accreditation. And if this is the case, you may be in a department that delegates ABET deliverables to the faculty. In this case, you will be asked to generate ABET documents such as the ABET syllabus, course objectives, and course outcomes. Also, ABET will request samples of teaching materials. So if this is your department, you'll want to get in touch with the ABET coordinator for your department and figure out if there's anything you need to do for your ABET course. Okay, now I'm going to discuss productivity benchmarks. So take this advice with a grain of salt because this is going to vary across discipline, across departments, and across campuses. But I think it's helpful for us as STEM people, engineers, to have some quantitative benchmarks just to give us an idea of what's expected of us at tenure. And this list of recommendations that I'm about to talk about are based on direct feedback that I've received and based on some open reviews that I've witnessed. Some departments have open reviews for merit, and I find that that's really helpful for junior faculty so you can create benchmarks in your mind for how productive you need to be. So this first bullet is pretty much describing how many papers you should publish. And so as a rule of thumb, you should be publishing double-digit papers by the time you are going up for promotion in 6 or 7 years. And the key to these papers is that someone from your group, including you, should be first, last author, or corresponding author, okay? This signifies that this is original research from your lab and you can take full credit for the intellectual contribution. You should have about $1 million in external funding. Now, once again, this is just a benchmark. You can come 50% higher or lower and you'll get promotion as long as you've done impactful research. But that's just a benchmark, and essentially you can get that with five small grants or two or three big grants, okay? And so it just, you should talk to someone about grant writing strategies, and we also talked about that in a previous episode of Under the Hood. An early career award, if you can secure that before you get tenure, that's also a good sign that you are marching toward promotion. So this will be the NSF Career Program, the DOE Early Investigator Program, Air Force Young Investigator Awards, etc. You also should have about 1 to 2 PhD students that are ready to graduate. And what this signifies is that you're able to train someone from the ground up to be a full-fledged, intellectually curious person who's ready to graduate with their professional degree. And you should be striving for satisfactory teaching. They usually suggest that we spend 70% of our time on research, 20% on teaching, and 10% on service. So you can mete out your time for teaching after your first offering to be more in line with those effort distributions. Now, if you need remediation based on your first offering in the teaching reviews, please take it, because if you don't, that could be marked negatively on any merit evaluation. So those are my best practices for productivity. The next thing I want to do is briefly talk about merit and evaluations. And so based on where you are, you could be evaluated every 2 years, every 3 years, or one time before you go up for tenure. So in the case where you are evaluated more regularly, I found that these evaluations are striving not only to look at how productive you are, but they are generally looking at the impact of the work that you've done. And impact can be demonstrated by the following: changes in research paradigms, public or campus policies, or practices that have manifested as a result of the original work that you've done as a faculty member. So if you can provide evidence that your efforts have had major impact on these things, this reflects positively in your merit and evaluation. If you happen to be in a department that has an evaluation after your first year as a faculty member, measure your expectations, you know, set a benchmark, but obviously you can strive to exceed that. And I would say a first-year faculty member, after a year, you've won maybe one or two little internal grants from campus. You've published one or two papers, maybe one from your group, and maybe it's a paper from data that you collected before you got to campus. Maybe you, in year one, you've established some strong collaborations and you've submitted proposals with other new collaborators on campus, and you've recruited one or two PhD students. So this is typical for someone in their first year. Everyone understands that the first year is hard. So just be kind to yourself. The other thing I recommend when it comes to being evaluating and preparing for your evaluation, I suggest you go back to the academic personnel manual just to see what the standard is for being evaluated. This also gives you a little bit of support to advocate for yourself in case anything goes awry in your first evaluation. Finally, when it comes to your evaluations, please, please, please keep your CV current, okay? Or if there is a software available to put in all your productivity, you need to constantly update that. The most annoying thing is doing a year's worth of work, 2 years, 3 years worth of work, and you haven't kept good records, and you have to build a CV for your evaluation or update it, and you're completely overwhelmed because you've forgotten some really important things that you've done. So I would suggest every semester that you update the following: any students that you've mentored, both formally and informally. Update the courses you taught. Keep a record on the enrollment and how many students were in the class. Conference activity, presentations you've given, sessions you've organized, and any conference boards that you've served on. Presentations, public, department, university, and other professional presentations. You should be keeping a record of the title, where you presented, and what the venue was. Your service, keep a record of every committee you've served on, any positions, technical advisory boards, editorial boards that you may be on, keep a record of that. And last but not least, keep your publications updated. You may want to check with the personnel coordinator about what's counted in your evaluation, whether or not submitted, accepted, or fully published counts. And so I tend to put submitted papers in my evaluations, not so much in prep papers. Unless you can provide a manuscript for an in prep paper, you probably want to leave that off. Non-refereed works, you will want to include book chapters, technical reports, conference proceedings that don't require peer review, but you'll want to mark them as being non-refereed. So this concludes my discussion of merit and evaluation best practices. Next, I'll discuss some general other best practices that I think are important for new faculty. Do attend any new faculty orientations on campus. This can be super helpful for getting your bearings and learning what's important to campus. Email management. If you hate email, this is going to be a really challenging part of the job. What I recommend for email management is establish a labeling system, label your emails right away. And when it comes to evaluating whether or not you want to respond, this is the rule of thumb that you may want to implement. If you can include whatever they're asking you to do on your CV, then you can respond. Otherwise, you probably want to politely decline whatever it is they're asking you to, or you may not, you know, have time to respond to it. Not only that, if you've established your group's research mission, your impact mission, you can refer to that mission and compare whatever the request is against that mission. And if the request via email does not support your group's mission, that's also something that you should be able to decline, okay? You are a first-year faculty. You're trying to establish your work ethic, your impact in the field. You do not have time for silly requests. Okay, your most valuable resource as a faculty member is your time. All right, so once again, when you're getting all these emails, if it doesn't relate to your research, teaching, or service, you need to strongly consider not responding. The next thing I want to talk about is your online presence. Please, please, please establish your website as soon as possible. We talked about branding in the interview discussions earlier in this series. So go ahead and get your branding up and running. There also may be a place on the department's website where you can have a faculty profile. Go ahead and lightly fill that out and then link your lab website to the department website. Or you can put the URL to your lab website on the department's website, but don't leave your department website blank. And you also want to always have a public-facing CV available for download. Now, when I say public-facing, this means that you may want to remove the patents that you have pending if they're based on proprietary work. Or if you have a late-breaking paper you're afraid that's going to be scooped, you can leave that. And it's in review, you can leave that off. If you are not comfortable just yet putting your funding amounts online, you can leave off the dollar amount. So I always keep a version of my full CV, and anything that I think is sensitive in nature, I will take it off the public-facing CV. Last but not least, your service. This is where you need to be really strict and talk to your chair about service expectations. But in general, I only recommend that you serve in one role maximum, and that can be at the department level. What that allows you to do is get to know your colleagues, and you get to know some of the department management so that you won't be too lost during the faculty meetings. Do show up for faculty meetings. It also helps you get your bearings as well. You get to learn about department culture, etc. That concludes my discussion of the other general best practices. And last but not least, this is kind of a kicker. You will likely have work that is lingering on from your postdoctoral research experience, or if you're a recent grad from grad school, you may have a couple papers that you're trying to push out from your dissertation. You're gonna have to balance this in your first year, all right? Most people do. So if you have to start your faculty position right away after a postdoc, don't worry, it's possible to get all this work done while ramping up at your new institution. So here are my recommendations. You may need to implement what's called a second shift. Some people that I mentor, they know I talk about second shift. And I find that second shift is kind of the difference between great and excellent when it comes to research productivity. And don't worry, you won't have to implement second shift for long. It only happens when you're trying to finish up work from your previous institution. So I recommend that you focus on your on-campus duties during the day, like your general working hours and business hours. Just focus on that. And then second shift includes nights and weekends, okay? Second shift is when you are putting in that extra work to push out that other work, because you want to get that off your plate as soon as possible. You need all of your cognitive energy for conceptualizing new grants, training your new trainees, and establishing a new and independent research identity. So try to get that stuff off your plate. As far as affiliations on the papers from your previous position, I usually use the new faculty affiliation on the work as well as the previous if the bulk of the work was completed at my new institution. If I'm using my faculty desktop computer, if I'm using any analytical equipment on campus to finish up any lingering work, the affiliation should go on the paper. The other thing I really, really highly recommend, since you'll be splitting your time, obviously you're going to be moving a little bit more slowly on the lingering work. Please be transparent with those collaborators and just let them know honestly that you need a little bit more time to get adjusted to your new job. This transition period as a new faculty member is non-trivial. It is difficult. It is trying you are drinking from a fire hose, and essentially a mirror is being held up to you. So all of your insecurities just get pulled to the forefront when you're learning to accept criticism, you're learning to teach, you're learning to get in front of people, express your ideas, and just take whatever criticisms that they have. So you need time to get used to being in this role, get used to being a public figure, get used to managing your energy appropriately, because you're on campus all day, you're talking a lot. So for those of you that don't like to talk, I don't know how you do it, okay? Maybe you're only emailing, but that energy that goes into ramping up on campus does take time away from the lingering work, and so you really need to be transparent with your collaborators. That concludes my discussion about lingering work. So congratulations to you, first-year faculty. I hope this series was helpful to you. If there's anything else that you want to know about, feel free to drop a comment in the comment section below, and I wish you all the best in your tenure track journey. This is Dr. Sunshine with Under the Hood Faculty Position Series.